Well, on the urban debate today, we're focusing on you as always. We're talking about whether or not it's time to begin buying property again. Now, I know a lot of us have been holding on to our checkbooks and our approved home loans, wondering if it's really time to get back into the market, because the big question of whether or not prices will fall still looms large. If prices are going to fall, should you hold on and wait for that to happen? Or is this the bottom? And is it time to get in and start buying right now? On the panel with me this evening, Ravi Ahuja of Cushman and Wakefield, Amit Goenka, Managing Director and CEO at NiFCO, Devina Ghildial is the Managing Director South Asia at RICS, joins us from the Noida studio. Thank you all of you for joining us right now on the show. Now, if you're watching and you're wondering whether or not it's time to start investing in property, what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw open the phone lines. There'll be a home phone line flashing at the bottom of your screen. Pick up the phone and call us, and we'll answer any question you might have about buying property. What are the hot neighborhoods? Where should you buy that property? That's the question we're answering this evening. I'm going to do a round of opening questions. Ravi Ahuja, will the prices come down even further? Are the numbers you're looking at right now for the latest quarter in any way different from what we've seen for the rest of the year?
Yeah, I think the prices have started to soften. So if you step back for a moment and we look at the last two quarters, we have actually seen a price correction. And therefore, it's probably the price correction in all likelihood may continue for the next couple of quarters. The current fillip, which the primary launches have seen, particularly at the beginning of the festive season and till late, are probably green shoots, as we may want to call it. But
So just let me understand this. You're saying that prices are likely to fall further. We know there was a report that came out of this quarter that said sales in Mumbai were up 28%, which means that Mumbai in the quarter that ended September sold 28% more homes than it did in the same quarter last year. Tell us how to understand that number. What does that mean?
So, you know, I was just saying that this number, is it a one-off or is it sustainable? I was actually commenting on that. Is there a revival in demand which is sustainable? Is something we need to see. Prices have come off, and that has been a good time for fence sitters. That has been a good time for self-users to get the check out and get your 10-15% discounts that they've got. In addition to the price correction, there has been excellent schemes of 2080, for example. And some of the reputed developers have also come out and launched. So which you mentioned that there has been good sales happening of under construction and new launch projects are actually of reputed developers. So I think the trust and the brand in, let's say, projects which are owned and going to be delivered by the likes of the Godrej Properties at Vikhroli or Oberoi's have seen some good responses. Does that mean it's going to sustain? It's something we need to deliberate. Essentially, there are good green shoots, and whether they will sustain or not will depend on two or three kind of criteria here. To my mind, the interest rate moderation has worked in favor, and going forward next year again is expected to keep coming down.
Okay, I'm going to bring Amit in here. Amit, you look at a PE investment fund, which means you're investing money right now. Are you investing money in this market, and can we take any cues from what you're looking at in terms of research?
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, the problem is that there are very few opportunities, and there's a problem of plenty in terms of money. So I'm actually fighting a battle with my peers in terms of where I can get it first.
In terms of money, it means that you have a lot of money and not enough opportunities.
I'm just saying the industry at large is actually flush with a lot of funds. And they've been, us as investors have been sitting on the fence as well for a very long period of time. You know, effectively, really post 2008 to 2012-13, there's been very little capital that has got deployed. So suddenly the urge to invest has also gone up in a very, very large way, which means that there's a huge amount of opportunity set both for the investors and for the buyers when it comes to the residential market space in India.
So Ravi told us that there might be a possibility that resi might come down even further over the next couple of quarters, which means that this is really technically not the time to buy. That means that we should be holding on to our checkbooks a little longer.
Well, you know, when I look at margins, you know, because we do a lot of deep dive into the margins of various projects, and we look at really whether there's sustainability at the other end of the curve, we'd realize that really people have skinned themselves down to the bone, and there's really, really very little room for error when it comes to profiteering or for holding back inventory.
So you're saying that right now builders have reached a point where they're functioning or they're pricing at almost no margin whatsoever.
Well, or very thin margins, just enough to cover the interest and other operating
expenses. But if sales don't move, then that margin, I mean, they'd have to go below the cost price.
Which
they'd
is the risk factor, and which is why I think there's been also an upturn in terms of the sales numbers, as you reflected. Because clearly, I think on the back of various financial schemes, on discounts, on various festive offers, and what have you, there's been a gradual pass on of that margin to the consumer, which has obviously been accentuated in a very large way by the governmental policies, the RBI policy rate cuts, and so many other macroeconomic indicators.
All right, I'll bring Devina in here. Devina, what is your research telling you? Of the cities that we focus on, the big cities, Mumbai, Pune, the NCR, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, what is research showing you? Which market is turning around, if at all?
Well, if I were to really, you know, talk about this, Faye, when we talk about the Mumbai market, really, statistics have been really looking a little good. There have been numbers, like you just mentioned, a report where we talked about saying that residential sales in the last four quarters has been up 28%. If you compare it to the similar period last year, if you look at registrations as well. You know, that's been up in the last 6 to 7 months. Registrations of houses have been up by about 15%. If you look at the festive season in particular, that is October month by itself, that's been better by 25% as against last year. So definitely good signs. But yes, as we see it, more end user driven.
All right, more end user driven. Amit, I'm going to come back to you here. So both of our other panelists are talking about end user markets at this point, which is the person who's going out to buy a house to live in. But if I'm an investor, which is, you know, I'm buying my second home, I'm buying a third home, I'm looking to just make money off this market. From that point of view, does it make sense to enter now?
Well, traditionally, there have been two classes of investors, one which have held on to real estate as a long-term investment asset class. And those people are still there in the market. And there have been the traditional, or rather the flippers, you know, very, very prominent in markets like NCR, to some extent in markets like Mumbai, which have really withdrawn, taken a very large back step and have disappeared from the market. You know, so clearly, I think it is a story for the consumer. It's a story for the long-term investor who's looking to eventually use that apartment for leasing or for earning a rental income. And eventually, as appreciation does come back, is then looking to make some capital upside or appreciation on the asset class. So yes, it is a long-term asset play. And so the fundamentals of real estate investment are actually now getting...
So let's break it up. And I'm going to ask each of our panelists this. Of the cities that we track, or sub-neighborhoods, even if you want to look at, say, a Thane or, a Navi Mumbai or a Whitefield in a Bangalore, what are the neighborhoods right now that's seeing the most or the strongest uptake? Which do you think are going to be the most bullish, Ravi?
I think we have done some research on this, and Pune shows some good signs going forward, followed by Mumbai. Mumbai, these green shoots or these statistics are very, very, very promising. And if they sustain, it'll be great to see a further first quarter sale.
Where in Pune, if we break up Pune as a market?
Pune, particularly the eastern corridor, looks very promising. Mm-hmm. The entire IT corridor, which is usually generating more employment right up to Kharadi on the periphery and starting Nagar Road. That entire belt looks good. The NIBM road particularly has seen a big influx of reputed developers who have started projects over the last 12 to 18 months. Sales volumes have picked up there. Coming back to Mumbai, we have to be cautious because today there is a supply overhang or an inventory overhang, as we call it, for about 3.5 to 4 years. So even if sales have picked up, probably, that will show signs and has to sustain over a period of time for supply to start getting absorbed and therefore prices to stabilize. But right now, there is an oversupply situation and therefore the pricing pressure will remain downwards.
So when you say Pune and you're talking about Kharadi and Nagar Road, is there no oversupply or overhang in Kharadi and Nagar Road?
No, I'm not saying there's no overhang and oversupply, but I'm just saying the offtake or the absorption and, demand is probably meeting a slightly more better than, let's say, Mumbai or... Of late, we've seen Bangalore come off. About a quarter ago, we used to talk Bangalore in a different light. But the statistics in Bangalore shows that the sales over there have also just plateauing and now coming off.
You know, also, since we talk about Bangalore in a different light, and until last quarter, in fact, we talked about how Bangalore sort of, bucks the trend, has not slowed down like the rest of the cities, continues to do well. But Pune tends to also mirror Bangalore that way. So is there a likelihood a quarter or two down the line, Pune will also start to slow down if Bangalore has begun already?
No, not necessarily, because see, Bangalore is a 100% IT-driven market. Today, there are reasons why IT is doing well. The segments of e-commerce are expanding, they're getting funded, there's new employment generated. Pune, on the other hand, has not only the benefits of an IT city, but also has a lot of industrial, which is brick and mortar kind of demand that comes in. And we've seen some of the corporates really go in there, the auto majors, the engineering firms. They've taken large tracts of land, and Pune is expanding. The city has gone beyond Chakan, you know, on one hand, and beyond Hinjewadi on the other hand, on the IT, which is creating a lot of demand. So,
all right, so I'm going to stop you there. I just want to bring our audience's attention to the chart on your screen right now. This is Kharadi for this year, at least. It's currently priced at about 6,350 rupees per square foot on an average. And there's a lot of very different construction coming up in Kharadi right now. Where do you expect this to go, Ravi, in the years to come?
In terms of pricing?
Yes, in terms of capital appreciation.
Well, I think it's going to probably be steady, 3 to 5% on the upside. But over a period of next 3 years to 5 years, I think it will catch up to about 10 to 12%.
10 to 12%. All right, Amit, tell us where you're putting your money.
Well, I think the stories are very vibrant still, I think, in Bangalore.
Okay.
Clearly, because it's led by a huge amount of commercial absorption, which means a lot of people are packing their bags and moving lock, stock and barrel into Bangalore, which is leading a lot of demand also for the residential space.
Where in Bangalore?
So again, there are a lot of places, whether it's Hoskote, whether it's Whitefield, whether it's a lot of parts of North Bangalore, including Yelahanka and Hebbal, have seen a huge amount of uptick towards the Manyata Tech Park side.
Mm.
Again, a lot of startup valleys are getting conceptualized and delivered in the south and southeast part of Bangalore. So these are very attractive markets along the outer ring road that we've started to actually invest our money in.
Okay, quick recap before we move on. You said Hoskote, you said Whitefield, anything around Manyata Tech Park, North Bangalore, Yelahanka, Hebbal, Hennur Road, these are the neighborhoods
That's right.
we're talking about. But before we move further, I'm told that we have a caller who's called us right now. Mahindra has called us. Mahindra, if you can hear me, tell me what your question is. How can we help you this evening? Mahindra?
हाँ जी
हाँ हाँ महेंद्र जी बोलिए आपको क्या जानना है
हमने मुंबई अपना थाना में वागले स्टेट में प्रॉपर्टी मतलब 20 लाख में लिया है तो क्या अच्छा है कि
ठीक है और आपने क्या लिया 20 लाख में
उधर रीसेल में एक घर लिया है मतलब 1 BHK
अच्छा और ये आप इन्वेस्टमेंट के तौर पे लिया है आपने रेंट पे दिया है आपने
रहने के लिए लिया है
और आपको क्या जानना है
क्या मतलब अच्छा है कि आगे चलते कुछ फायदा होएगा क्या
अच्छा ओके रवि डू यू वांट टू टेक दैट ही इज बॉट वागले एस्टेट इन थाने रीसेल प्रॉपर्टी एट 20 लाख रुपीस व्हाट सॉर्ट ऑफ एप्रिसिएशन कैन ही एक्सपेक्ट दैट्स On your screen right now, that's the chart for this year at least. It's about 12,000 rupees a square foot. Where do you expect this to go?
So if you look at Wagle Estate, and since he asked the question in Hindi, I would assume that he would understand Hindi better and he's listening to us.
Sure.
So Wagle Estate has, you know, ek transformed jaisa hua hai from industrial, corridor, jo Wagle Estate, industrial estate hote the. Now it has moved more towards IT development, which is now permitted on those industrial plots.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, we are seeing a lot of employment generation. There's an oversupply in the office IT space over there.
Mm.
But what that means for resi or residential demand is the more employment it will generate over a period of time, residential demand will sustain. And I see prices over a period of time not only stabilizing, but probably giving you an upside of 5 to 10%. But I think in the next 12 months, one has to be fairly complacent with steady or stable prices, no appreciation.
Okay, Mahindra ji, Ravi, aise bol rahe ki obviously aapko appreciation hoga kyunki Wagle Estate mein abhi IT park aa raha hai, to wahan se naukriya honge aur log aayenge wahan pe rehne ke liye. To ek do saal to rukni padegi aapko, lekin obviously appreciation milega. To acha decision liya aapne.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Same question. I'm going to go to Devina right now. Devina, of the markets you're looking at, which one are you most bullish on? Which one do you expect to recover the fastest? And we're talking across the cities right now.
Okay, so if we were to talk about, if we're looking at the commercial space, we did this research where Bangalore actually topped across countries. It was the top three locations globally when it comes to commercial appreciation that we're really looking at. But if you're talking about a residential side of it, then I would say Bombay is looking good right now. There is demand, particularly although fence sitters who've been sitting now can actually see a stage where things are a lot more affordable, because the last 2-3 years the property prices have kind of stagnated, but income has grown up, has increased. You've had your home loans become cheaper, interest rates have gone down. So effectively, if we are talking about all the discounts that the builders are giving, you're 15% more affordable than you were earlier.
Well, Devina, actually, interest rates have not come down that much. Now, from the beginning of this year, which is 2015, the RBI has given us a total interest rate cut of about 1.25%. Banks have only passed on 60 basis points or 65 basis points, which is half as much. Banks have really not passed on all of it. So we haven't really seen interest rates really effectively come down for the home buyer. Is that the only reason why we're seeing some sort of an uptick in Mumbai? And is that sustainable then?
Well, I think as far as that is concerned, my interest rate comment was for the last 2-3 years, actually. So was the comment on the stagnation in property. So I think we've seen some amount of reason to cheer. Yeah. Will it actually sustain itself? It remains to be seen. If we look at the sentiment index, the real estate purchase sentiment index, that's also gone up, which essentially tells us that while statistics are looking good, we are also possibly seeing a lot more of the end users coming in for some time. How long that stays, it remains to be seen.
All right, very quickly, also, when you talk about Mumbai, give me specific markets that you're seeing an uptick in.
Well, I don't think I'd really want to get into sub-markets, because we prefer to look at it from a state-level perspective. I think Ravi or Amit would be more suited for that.
Ravi or Amit. Amit? If you talk about Mumbai?
Yeah, so there are parts of Mumbai which have shown a lot of resilience, which are really the infrastructure corridors. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of research and a lot of bite that have already been put up about that, and I think they continue to have a lot of steam. So for example, the Chembur micro market is still very attractive.
And that's because of the Eastern Freeway.
That's exactly. So the Chembur Wadala, of course, Wadala has already, I think, seen some peak. I think the Lower Parel market is extremely, extremely interesting.
Interesting why?
Interesting in terms of an upside potential now, because really the land bank has been exhausted. Mm. It's been now touted as the first smart city of Mumbai.
I work out of Lower Parel. It's not smart, I'll tell you that.
Well, I don't know. It is not. But it is, I mean, the way in terms of the concept of having everything within South Bombay of work, play and and live out of, it's still looking at having.
So what you're saying is, given the kind of construction that's coming up in Lower Parel, Worli, Paikala, all of these neighborhoods, Central Mumbai is going to be the next high end neighborhood.
I don't deny that. So the traditional areas of Upper Worli, or which is now the New Worli, so I think Bandra has therefore seen downsides. They've been, the South Bombay has seen a little bit of a dip, and I think they'll continue to kind of come off from their historical highs. But I think the new developments which are coming up in the Central Mumbai.
When was the last time we saw a chart like this about Central Mumbai? Worli's prices come down 5% this year.
Absolutely.
We started, about a year or two ago, and Worli was being priced closer to 40,000 rupees a square foot. It's coming down even further. We know that there are apartments under construction that are bringing prices down on a regular basis. Right. How much longer is this going to continue? How many more opportunities can we expect?
Well, I think because of the sheer volume that has been coming up in this area, I think the opportunity is now kind of stabilizing in terms of price points, where the only place that looks to happen is actually go up. But the same thing we saw with commercial real estate in Lower Parel. Mm-hmm. It actually took a very huge beating from what was expected at the time of bid to what was actually offered in the market. And now clearly, it's bucked the trend and it's gone up and it's continued to go up in a very large way. I see residential actually kind of following that trend very soon.
All right. We have a phone. We have another viewer who's called us on the phone line. Sameer, I believe, has called us from Navi Mumbai. Sameer, how can we help you?
Yeah, I have taken one property Karangade for 2.5 years, and I have taken at 4,000 rupees per square foot. Okay, and this is for purely an investment purpose. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to know whether to sell the property or to retain it for, and how many years I have to wait for a bit return.
Okay, first of all, Sameer, tell me, where have you bought this property?
Karangade, Panvel.
Panvel, okay. And is this a two-bedroom? What is the total cost you bought it at?
Yeah, it's a 980 square foot flat. And I have taken at 4,000 rupees per square foot.
Okay, so he's bought in Panvel, Ravi. Should he hold on to it? Is it? It's really not a great time to sort of enter the market for a sale, is it?
But if he's already bought it, so he's entered. Now he's asking whether he should stay or exit.
Yeah, and he's had it for 2.5 years. Yeah. But it's not a seller's market right now, is it?
It is not a seller's market. If he goes to sell, I think he will lose value because the sales over there are quite stagnant. So the peripheral areas of Panvel, just like we have on the western side, the Virar belt, are seeing almost stagnant sales. And anyone who goes to sell has to discount deeply, maybe as low as 10 to 20% fall from rack rates. My suggestion is to hold on unless 2.5 years has given him an upside, which he's willing to further cut some loss in his profits and get out.
Let's consider the fact that Navi Mumbai Airport, which we've been waiting for now for 10 years, has finally got its set of clearances. And from what we understand on the channel, that we might actually see some sort of orders being given out maybe early next year for the Navi Mumbai Airport. What sort of a change will that make to New Panvel if there's an airport there?
I think the airport has been a hyped event. And even if it happens, I think there just may be a temporary blip before people realize that it's going to take another 6-7 years for the light of the day for the first aircraft to land over there. So to my mind, just upon the announcement, within a quarter or so, if you know people can get lucky to sell, it'll be a great exit. But if he wants to make long-term money, it's a no-brainer. Panvel is on the map. 3 to 5 years, if he holds on, there will definitely be a comeback.
So, Samir, the advice you're getting right now is hold on for at least 3 to 5 years if you're willing to do so. Are you okay with holding on for 3 to 5 years?
Yes.
Okay, we seem to have lost. Samir, if you can hear us, can you hold on for the next 3 to 5 years? Maybe rent out the property in the meantime?
Yes. Thanks.
All right, Sami. The city we haven't spoken about so far is the NCR, the National Capital Region. Most of our analysts and panelists have sort of like skirted the NCR, not mentioned it at all in the first 20 minutes of conversation. We have to talk about it. It's a massive, massive market. Devina, you're in Noida right now. The words overhang, oversupply, slow sales, delays, frustration, helplessness, these are the words we hear when we normally talk about the NCR on this channel. Are you seeing any sort of signs of life in that market in terms of numbers?
I'd love to be able to say that I do, but frankly, that's not really the case. I think as far as markets are concerned, which is why when we talked earlier as well, we talked about Bombay and Bangalore, because NCR at this point in time is at the trickiest situation that it can be. And I think with the real estate regulation bill possibly happening, the one to benefit also most will be this market.
Will be the NCR region. You know, a lot of people are asking us now, areas like Golf Course Extension, areas like Greater Noida, the expressway, are these areas, considering the pricing, 6,500 rupees a square foot, it seems like a great deal. Does it make sense at this point? And any of our panelists who want to jump in and are comfortable talking about prices, does it make sense at this point to enter these neighborhoods and say, okay, you know what, if I'm getting a great construction at 4,500 rupees a square foot in Greater Noida, I should go ahead and buy?
Well, I would personally put my money in there, because if I had the money to actually stay in there for the next 5 to 7 years, I think it's really coming out at the cost of construction. I mean, you're discounting land prices in a very large way. People are just really, really trying to get their money back as far as the development companies and developers are concerned.
But I would also be taking on a lot of risk then in terms of delivery, because we know that, you know, Noida's had
I'm talking of ready-to-move-in inventory. It's unbelievable that the kind of ready-to-move-in inventory that's available and all of it, or bulk of it, is actually all in NCR. If you go and scout around for lock-and-key inventory in Bangalore or Chennai, maybe to some extent, Mumbai, hardly any, I think NCR is the place to go. I mean, you'll get ready-to-move-in inventory at absolutely crazy prices. So clearly, I mean, if I have money for the 5 to 7 years to stay put, I think the upside really has to come off from there, because it's really, really crashed.
Okay, I'm going to bring your attention to the chart that's on the screen right now. This is Noida, Greater Noida Expressway. This information comes from our partner, magicbricks.com. It says it's priced on an average at 4,755 rupees a square foot. It's up 27% this year. What is the reason for that uptick? Ravi, do you want to take a stab at that?
No, I think maybe Devina can add, but on Greater Noida, it always used to be that it was remote. Yeah. It was a little further away in terms of access and reach. Having said that, prices never really scaled up. It's not a surprise that the prices had been lying low. NCR saw in regions like Gurgaon, in regions like proper Noida Expressway, prices sure. went up and now mm. have stabilized and come down. Mm. But that market, which never really took off and went up, has probably started moving. That's my logic.
Let's also look at Gurgaon. I'm going to ask my producer to put that up on our screen as well. So we'll try and look at a couple of neighborhoods in Gurgaon and see what sort of uptick we've seen, at least this year, to see whether or not it's a good time. So DLF City Phase 1 has come down 2%. We haven't seen too much movement there. It's priced at about 10,000 rupees a square foot. Golf Course Extension Road. Has been largely almost flat this year. And we're getting a lot of questions about Golf Course Extension. Amit, would you risk your money at Golf Course Extension Road?
Well, it's hard to say, because I think the definition of Golf Course Extension is actually really extended to the entire sort of, entire belt, which is really going down to deep into Gurgaon. But I think the real answer is I would not. Mm-hmm. I would wait and watch, because Gurgaon for me is a very, very risky market right now.
So you prefer Noida over Gurgaon?
I would, of course.
What about Faridabad, Ghaziabad, all of those other
areas? Prefer them compared to Noida and Gurgaon any day, because they're okay. really consumer markets. Okay. There are not a lot of speculators which have traditionally lived out of Ghaziabad or Indirapuram or Faridabad or any of these belts. It's really consumer-driven markets. They've seen very flattish kind mm-hmm. of prices. The appreciation have been only because of organic consumptions. So they're not speculative micro markets too.
So I'm going to make this simple for our audience. You're saying Faridabad, Ghaziabad, then Noida, then Gurgaon. If at all possible, avoid Gurgaon completely.
Yeah, I mean, that's my take right now. Yes.
Ravi, what's your, if you were to rearrange those names, is it the same thing?
It may be the same, except the Gurgaon, if you get a really good deal, because the price fall has been quite significant. Mm. And I think not Golf Course Extension. If you get a good deal at the Golf Course Road itself, which will remain prime and which will bounce back whenever there is the first positive sign, I would probably go with Golf Course. I know Vipul has just launched a project which is seeing some great traction and good advice from consultants to go and buy, because the price is not only reasonable.
Are you consulting on that project?
No, not really.
Okay.
But at the same time, there are hundreds who are. Okay. I know that is one project people have been waiting for because of the connectivity. Likewise, Faridabad, on the other hand, like Amit was saying, is quite central. Commute-wise, it's easy to access compared to Greater Noida, which is still considered to be a little remote. But I would not change the order, probably.
Okay, not changing the order. Devina, you had something to add? Do you disagree with the man?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, not really disagree, but to an extent, I would agree. The bit about Greater Noida showing appreciation, because it actually hadn't picked up in the rally. But on the other hand, Gurgaon, of course, hit the roof. So we reached a stage where it is, bound to actually start seeing stagnation or a lower thing. I wouldn't actually put Ghaziabad up on the radar, because while I believe there's no doubt that the pricing hasn't gone up to that extent, but infrastructure maybe is not that great for us to be able to look at it. So my bet would still be on, if you're looking at demand, really, I would turn back and say if it's a good developer, if it's a good project which is ready, because I think, construction delays is the biggest thing.
Okay.
And, there are a lot of good pricing that's out in the market.
All right. Let's take a look at Pune. We have a caller from Pune right now. Munaf Khan is on the phone. He's called us live. Munaf, tell us what your question is. How can we help you?
Yes. Hi, this is my question. Is that I want to know the prospect for the area called Undri, because I had purchased agricultural land 3 years back, and I want to know what is the prospect. Should I hold it now or should I sell it?
How much land have you bought in Undri? What is the size of the plot of land that you're holding? All right. We do know, of course, that Pune has appalling connectivity.
8,000 square feet land.
8,000 square feet of agricultural land in Undri.
8,000 square feet.
Okay. 8,000 square feet of agricultural land in Undri. We're looking at the price. But, of course, the price on our screen is of residential property per square foot. We're talking right now about agricultural land. Do any of you want to take a stab at that? That's a nice packet of land to be holding in Undri, which is starting to get a lot of attention in Pune. So he's done a good job in terms of picking it. He's been holding it for 3 years. Hold on to it longer, and what sort of appreciation can he expect?
I wouldn't hazard a guess on the kind of appreciation, but surely there will be appreciation. The fact that this is agricultural land, one has to see on the conversion of zoning and convert it to non-agricultural. That itself will give him an upside in terms of the capital value of the land that he holds. So A, that upside, and B, I think Undri as a location will keep populating, and therefore the land prices will certainly not soften from here, and he'll gain from the normal appreciation. So both of these combined together, he surely should.
Of course, one has to look at the new master plan at Pune. They've obviously been talking about the new master plan at Pune, which has kind of disrupted a lot of things in Pune. And if there is really a scope where this land really falls in the new R zone, then clearly the upside is can be quite tremendous, because really his cost is at about 800 rupees a square foot, and which is actually quite a pittance compared to what one can actually demand if one has to actually sell the land if it's in the residential zone with a road access.
Have you checked the new plan to figure out whether your land is still agricultural or you can convert it to residential?
I have checked this, and it's in the proposed residential zone, and soon it's going to be converted to residential zone in another year or
so. All right, so you seemed... Sorry, Ravi.
Just hold on.
You seem to be sitting pretty on a really good parcel of land. If it's been converted to residential zone, it makes sense to get that conversion done and pay those dues as quickly as possible, right, Ravi?
Yes, 100%. And hold on, that's very, very positive sign that you will see a very decent capital appreciation after a year whenever this converts.
All right, so go ahead, hold on, make sure you approach the municipality, get the conversion done, pay all your dues, hold on to those papers. This is going to work out well for you. I have another viewer on the phone line. KB Patel joins us from Ahmedabad. Mr. Patel, go ahead, tell us what we can help you with this evening.
Hello.
Yes, tell us what your question is.
Hello.
Mr. Patel, can you hear us?
Yes.
पटेल जी बताइए आपका क्वेश्चन क्या है
चल गया
जी
मैं अबाउट 20 लाख के आसपास 2 BH का फिर खरीदना चाहता हूँ
जी
2 BH का फिर खरीदना चाहता हूँ अहमदाबाद अच्छा ये कौन सी जगह मिलेगा अच्छी साइट पर
ठीक है ठीक है रवि ही वांट्स टू बाय एन अफोर्डेबल होम ऑफ 15 टू 20 लाख रुपीस 2 bedrooms इन अहमदाबाद Well, Ahmedabad, while it has not run up like the rest of the cities we were talking about, it's still difficult to get 15, 20 lakh rupees in Ahmedabad. He's still going to have to go to the outskirts of the city. Are there any neighborhoods which are still priced in that bracket?
No, I wouldn't hazard naming a neighborhood, but you're right. He will have to go at least about 7-8 kilometers outside the city limits. I think the highway, which is the SG highway, and the more further he goes, the prices will drop. So there are a lot of options there, which eventually, because it's a highway, it's well connected, eventually we'll see appreciation.
Though of course, the South Bhopal was supposed to be an affordable segment for quite some time. And now it's actually run up to almost about 4,500 to 5,000 rupees a square foot. So he's really looking to buy something in the sub 3,000 category. I mean, there could be some old developments which could still be sold at maybe 3,000 to 3,500 rupees a square foot in the Bhopal region. And of course, SG Highway continues to be a very important belt, especially more going towards Gandhinagar than coming towards the Ahmedabad side. Because a lot of people who actually now gone and started looking at affordable housing, including even Godrej, who started to reduce their size of apartments and offering more 500, 600 square feet type of apartments, within that vicinity. I think also the Adani development, I mean, it may not be within 20 lakhs, could be 25, 28 lakhs. But again, there are a lot of apartments which are being now offered in the sub 25 lakh category, which is within a 8 to 10 kilometer radius from the city center. So I think there are reasonable options depending on which side of Ahmedabad one wants to reside. Yes, you can go deep down into
SG. I want to also bring in Devina very quickly. Devina, we know that Ahmedabad is interesting right now for a couple of reasons. One, it's the Prime Minister's home city. It's going to receive a fair amount of attention. It's the biggest nodular city on the Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor. There's a lot of smart city work that's happening there. So Ahmedabad, in terms of infrastructure and attention from the government, is very well placed. Tell us from your studies right now.
And the bullet train,
apart from other things. Lots of industry, lots of auto sector, lots of action happening in Ahmedabad. Because of manufacturing, there will be affordable housing as well. Tell us what sort of numbers you're looking at in the city of Ahmedabad and how much of that is coming from affordable housing.
See, I wouldn't really go into numbers, but yes, Ahmedabad is a market that I think a lot of us are really watching out for, more so because of the Smart Cities initiative. There's no doubt that it being, Gujarat being the state that we are looking at, it's a high focus market. You've got some good developers who are working out of that. So definitely going to be a high focus area, but numbers would be tough to say at this point in time. But we would want to keep it on the watch.
So, Mr. Patel, that's your answer. There are South Bhopal is probably a good neighborhood to look at, or there are kafi sare developers hai jo wahan pe affordable housing bana rahe hain, aur hamari team se koi aapko phone karke aapko wo pura developers ki list bata denge. I also believe Vijay Kumar is on the phone line from Delhi. He's just called us as well. Vijay, tell us what your question is.
Ma'am, I just wanted to know what is the prospect of project Kaisichia on Alwar Bypass Road in Bihar. So what application I can get in, say, 3 to 4 years from that project?
Okay, so you're looking at Essentia in Bhiwadi. You're buying it for an investment, if I'm not mistaken. Is that your question? Bhiwadi is also getting a lot of attention simply from an investment point of view. But then again, you know, like Ahmedabad, and this is my problem with these neighborhoods that are on the DIMC, the industrial corridor, manufacturing will bring in a workforce that needn't necessarily buy houses. Whereas IT and BPO and banking, those services, the entire workforce tends to buy houses that are being built. Ravi, would you recommend he goes ahead and buys in Bhiwadi as an investment?
So, because it's an investment, I would be cautious at this time. Bhiwadi has already seen a lot of price appreciation over the last 2-3 years.
There's also talk of an airport.
Yeah, there's a talk of an airport, but I think that's still distant. We've not seen the approvals. At the same time, we've seen it's being a warehousing hub. Of sorts. So there will be some traction in terms of logistics companies there and some employment there. I also know the government is planning a huge logistics hub there. So if that all shapes up, I think there will be employment and therefore prices will stabilize, which had fallen off late. But I think investment may be long term. Not otherwise.
Actually, Amit, tell us this. When we're looking at making investments right now, this has been, you know, there's been a cat and mouse game that's been played in the NCR region. We thought there would be a new airport in the Noida area to sort of beef up Noida. Prices started to move up, and then it turned out that the airport was in the other end of the city in Gurgaon that already has an airport. So which would have been Bhiwadi? Now, again, we don't know. Those permissions have not come in. Should, as investors or home buyers, should we react at all to this kind of information?
I don't think, first of all, home buyers should be so cued on to what's really going to happen in the next 10 years.
Because, well, you know, it matters, because then we wind up missing the bus. Every time the metro comes into a neighborhood, people like you invest before we do.
Well, that's a different matter, because, you know, at the end of the day, we're looking for the short term. As a home buyer, you're not there for 2 years or 3 years. You're looking possibly for your next generation to also stay there. Mm. You know, so clearly in a market which has got its basic dynamics in place, its basic infrastructure and social amenities in place, I think obviously should be the choice. One is not really looking to buy because he should get extraordinary upside, because that's still a paper upside. You know, so clearly I think an infill location where you really want to stay, where you think your child should grow up, and I think sure that should
and
be the first choice.
And if I'm investing, if I'm buying a second home to flip later for
well, of course, then all those things do matter. But having said that, I think there needs to be a lot of traction on the ground for an infrastructure development to get started. So clearly, you know, a lot of people had been talking about the Eastern Freeway, but it actually really took off in Mumbai, for example, only when it actually came up. You know, so really, I see, for example, in the Navi Mumbai airport, when it comes up, really there will be a run. Otherwise, it's a lull. So I don't think one should speculate about infrastructure coming up till it's actually really there and it starts to get employed.
All right, Rahul Sharma is on the phone line from Delhi as well. Rahul, good evening. Tell us, what can we help you with?
Yeah, see, basically, I had basically bought a flat in 37D Gurgaon in last year. Mm. And this is basically on the Dwarka Expressway, and I'm seeing the prices since then have not really picked up. It's basically bought for an investment perspective. So just wanted to know what is the panel feel about the prospects about Dwarka Expressway, and because there are still some encumbrances I've heard which have not been cleared. So what is the panel's view on overall about the prospects?
You know, Dwarka Expressway ran into so much trouble for so long. It only started, and you can see it, it's on your screen right now. It only started to sort of react midi this year when we saw some of those clearances come in and some of those problems being sorted out, but it's not entirely sorted out. Ravi, do you want to hazard what's going on in Dwarka Expressway and whether it's a good idea to hold on to that apartment?
Sure. So I think the Dwarka Expressway, it currently boasts of, in a negative sense, of one of the highest inventory overhangs across the entire Dwarka Expressway. And that itself is an indication that if you have entered at a price and you're getting that price, probably you may look at an exit rather than holding on if you already bought a 2 BHK flat. I think there are other locations which will
spring up. But, you know, I mean,
earlier.
To be fair, will he find a buyer? If you're saying overhang, it means that entire stretch has buildings, which if you, you know, look at it at night, there isn't a single light on.
Yeah.
You know, there's no laundry hanging out of the balconies, which means sure. nobody lives there. Sure. So if you're saying exit, who is he going to exit to?
No, but look, when I say exit, he has to cut a loss here, right? And then move on to better location. So if he's willing to, otherwise it's a long-term hold, maybe 3 to 4 years.
Yeah.
All right, are you willing to hold it for 3 to 4 years?
I would say that. I think there's no option. You got to hold on.
Yeah.
And actually, the good part is, you know, I mean, let's not be so pessimistic about Dwarka Expressway. I think it's seen its fair share of troubles already.
Are the troubles over?
I think so, because, you know, for what I recently have known is that the land acquisition for completing the road is over. The government is now actually reasonably serious with such a large amount of investment already having gone in, not just from the developers, from the banks, from private equity, etc. They're now very serious about completing the road, giving the public utility connections and other things like that. So I would maybe think that in the next 18 to 24 months, you would see the public amenities and the utilities and the connectivity really come into the Dwarka Expressway, post which people will start to move in. And therefore, from a 3 to 4 year horizon perspective, I think it's a great story, because if you look at the price points,
let's assume, ₹5,235 per square foot on an average in Dwarka Expressway. But let's look at it this way. If Dwarka Expressway in the next 12 to 18 months, like you say, were to start to turn around, there's still all of that inventory that's available in that market will have to be absorbed. Which means buyers have to come in, buy all of that inventory. Then we'll start to see the prices coming up. How long will that take?
Well, if you saw the Noida story, I mean, there were acres and acres of land which really got absorbed overnight. I mean, so NCR has a very peculiar ability to actually take a millions of square foot almost overnight.
Hmm.
You know, so I wouldn't be surprised, really. So for the people who actually, you know, been waiting now on the wayside or on the fence for at least about 2 years now, actually jumping in at that price, because if it really takes up, and you're in Gurgaon, I mean, you're in Delhi, or you're in the bottom. I mean, so it's a great location, really. So
if you look at I can see Devina smiling right now. There's obviously something she did. What's your point?
Well,
on this?
If I were to say, I'm definitely saying he definitely can't let go of it right now, because as I see it, he's definitely looking at a situation where he'll be making some losses. If he has the ability to hold, and that is not a challenge, then he's definitely looking at being able to hold on, but not for the next 18 to 24 months. We're looking at a longer period.
No, I agree, Devina. I'm just saying that'll take possibly 4 years for the prices
Correct.
To start coming back up. I mean, in 18 to 24 months, I see absorption coming in maybe to some extent.
Okay. You know, I want to ask Rahul if he's still on the phone. Good. Rahul, are you okay with holding for the next 3 to 5 years? Okay, I don't know if we still have Rahul. Rahul, if you're watching the show, you're going to have to hold for the next 3 to 5 years at least before you can hope to make a profit. And even if you attempted to sell right now, it's going to be a long, painful sale where you'll have to keep dropping your prices till you get someone to buy. So it's really not a great prospect. So hold on if you can, really. Leaves you with very little choice. I also want to ask Amit this. Pay commission hike. We're going to see most government employees and pensioners will see a bump up of about 23%, 25% in their bank accounts every month starting the 1st of January. And we know, obviously, that a large impact of that happens in Delhi NCR.
Absolutely.
So we've seen in the past, every time there was a pay commission announcement, there'll be builders in the NCR region who will offer special deals to government employees to sort of attract and absorb that money. What sort of impact do you expect that to have on the Delhi market, the NCR market in general?
Well, you know, which is also the reason I always like the mid-market or the mid-segment locations, which is why I prefer an Indrapuram, a Ghaziabad, a Faridabad, maybe Noida, compared to a Gurgaon, because these are the micro-markets that really offer that segment the opportunity to actually live into a very, very stabilized mid-market community development. You know, so really see that actually translating into some amount of uptake in rentals, in consumption, and actually getting that money employed into, you know, long-term purchase of good assets. So clearly, I think the opportunity for the NCR market, and maybe even...
So you're saying the sweet spot for the NCR market is about 5,000 rupees a square foot right now?
Yes, exactly, because I mean 1,000 square feet, so 50 lakhs.
50
so the
lakhs,
sub 50
okay.
lakh segment is actually a great segment to be in the NCR region. And clearly, this is the segment that will be afforded by the pensioners, because then you're effectively, you know, looking at roughly about 30 to 40,000 rupees a month sort of an EMI, you know, which is fantastic given the OROP scheme and other things.
Okay, so you're saying about 40 to 50,000 rupees, 40 to 50 lakh rupees in bracket, as close to occupation is possible, or you're saying ready to occupy is
well,
what
I think you know clearly.
At?
I mean, if you're a pensioner, if you're a, if you're part of the pay commission, you really want to get into a low risk asset class. Not a development asset class. You want to be able to earn rentals as opposed to look for capital appreciation.
So let's be honest about the NCR region. The other big problem is reputation, a trust deficit, and the builder's ability to simply deliver. And you know, what applies to the rest of the cities where you say, you know, go to the biggest guys, go to the guys who've been around the longest, go to the guys who have the most number of projects. None of that applies to the NCR region.
Right.
Because even the biggest guys right now are in trouble. So Ravi, I'm going to put you on the spot. If I'm going to pick a good, reliable builder in the NCR region, first of all, there's like barely a handful if you were to make a list. Tell us how to pick that, how to find that builder.
So I could name a few, but at the end of the day, so without naming, I think how to find them is a more critical question, which will help the viewers. The only way to find out is through hard work and homework, which you can get from references, from honest brokers and consultants who will let you know who has delivered in the last three years. And who have a delivery track record and who
are
not
brokers,
so leveraged.
You see.
Yeah, honest brokers. And there are a few. I would count IPCs as one of them, where we come from.
Okay.
So you could clearly rely on us. And look at the track record and the leverage. I think these two are the major criteria, apart from reputation and image, because no doubt.
I don't know how to tell what the leverage of a builder is, because though that's sort of, I mean, I'll be honest with you, most builders barely allow the buyer to look at the contract before he puts down a deposit. He's not going to show me his books. I'm not going to be able to tell how leveraged he is.
The consultant has a pulse on the leverage because they also help in funding both debt and equity to the developers on one side, as we have our own capital markets team. So that intelligence will help the buyer.
So now, if Amit has told us the 50 lakh rupee bracket, assume I'm buying a home for 50 lakh rupees in the NCR region, what will it cost me to get a consultant like you to look into that deal and look at the leverage of the builder and find a builder for me?
I think the builder overall one has to look at the package and not really a project, because a project may be highly leveraged, but a developer, if he's got 3-4 different projects, he definitely is looking at cash flows from all of them to let go and to make sure that the projects are doing well and getting off the ground consistently. So I think it's about the package, and it's about which developer is not in doldrums or is not ready to put his hands up.
I'm not entirely convinced. Devina, do you have a better answer for me? How do I find a builder who's not going to stall, whose construction is not going to stop, so we don't both wind up in consumer court in a year or two?
Well, I think my easiest answer would be to say go for a ready to move into property, because I think at this point in time that's the safest option in NCR. So I wouldn't really venture into projects. And when we are talking about projects and developers, absolutely, Ravi is right, where we are looking at the track record. We are not looking at a longer term track record and saying what has he done in 10 years or 15 years, but more recent, the last 3 years.
How much ready-to-occupy supply is there in the NCR region? If we talk about the markets we just focused on, is there enough for someone with 50 lakh rupees, as an allowance on a home loan and down payment? If I have the ability to buy 50, 60 lakh rupees worth of property right now, is there enough ready-to-occupy supply?
Well, I think, again, if we were to go back to Dwarka Expressway, I would say, given how things have been, a lot of distressed sales are out in the market. And yes, that would be the case today.
I think just to give a cue to people who are looking to buy, and I could possibly, give you an insight into the filters we apply, to figure out which is the right developer. Because obviously we don't know everybody ourselves before we put the money in. But clearly there are a few check boxes one should look at. Clearly,
sure.
The first one is, does he have all the approvals in place to finish the building?
Okay.
I think that's very critical.
How do I find that out?
It's available. No, it's available, and you can ask. A lot of documentation actually now requires that the title report along with all the approvals be attached to a purchase document. Today, given that it's a buyer's market, a lot of people are now willing to actually give you that data if you can find out. If you can't find out and the developer's cagey about it, I think it's a good red flag to actually, understand any which ways. So if the developer is transparent enough, he understands that it's a buyer's market and he's willing to actually play ball, go with projects which are fully approved, have all the FSI, TDR and every other approvals in place. Very important. Second, if it's funded by a PE and there are strict controls available available on the project by a financial institution, that's a good sign, because then the chances of financial indiscipline is so much lower, which means the money is getting applied for the project, the chances of it getting completed is much higher. A good financial institution will ensure that the money goes in for completion, because that's how they're going to get their money out. So I think that's a second good checkbox, is an institutional backed investor.
Okay, but okay, most of the PEs right now, especially in the NCR region, have been refinancing their debt because they haven't managed to get their money out. How do we read that as buyers?
Well, it's a good question, because again, I think a lot of things happened in the past, which was for land banking. Mm. You know, so the first round of money, because NCR really didn't see that kind of institutional capital, which happened in 2006, 7 to 2008, 9, was for land banking. That story's over, and those people need an exit. So the money which is A, now going in to refinance, is A, slightly cheaper, because it's not equity money, it's largely debt capital, so it's slightly cheaper. B is the people who are now bringing the money have actually put in very, very strict controls and very strict processes in place to ensure that the money comes out and the project gets delivered, as opposed to the equity investors who are just looking to ride the upside.
All right.
The solution to all these concerns and fears is just the real estate bill that the cabinet has just approved. So I just hope it gets a clear passage, and that will boost a lot of confidence to the buyer, be it NCR or any other market.
Right. Actually, on this channel as well, we support that bill tremendously, and we hope that it comes up as quickly as possible. I'm running out of time. Multiple choice questions to each of our panelists. Quickly, one word answer. Pune, Bangalore or Mumbai? Amit.
Bangalore.
Ravi, Pune, Bangalore or Mumbai?
Short term Pune, long term Mumbai.
All right. And Devina, Pune, Bangalore or Mumbai?
Both Bangalore and Mumbai.
All right. Bangalore gets more votes. I personally like Bangalore as well. Sure, go ahead. Go ahead, Devina.
No, if we were to look at Bangalore as well, I think if we look at the numbers, this month has been better than last month. And so we do kind of believe that, given that they don't have that much of inventory, an overhang to that extent, I think it'll pick up.
So where are you seeing that uptick in Bangalore? One location?
Well, I think, I wouldn't want to really get into regions, but as a whole, when we look at Bangalore as a market, I would still say that if I had to put my money, I would look at this point in time, Mumbai and Bangalore, not NCR.
All right, we're running out of time. Of course, Bangalore, you just avoid the traffic and you should be okay. Anything going in and out of Whitefield tends to be a complete nightmare right now. We're going to wrap up the show here. Remember, on this channel, we're here to help you, so you can get in touch with us. I'm going to put all of our coordinates on the screen right now. We also have a website called mbnow.in, where you can reach out and leave us a note if you like. Tell us what you want us to tackle in terms of real estate. What topics you prefer us to handle on the show, and we'll take that up for you. It'll be our pleasure to hear from you. Remember, you can reach me personally on Twitter as well. I want to thank all of our panelists for joining us live on the show this evening. And thank you for watching. Stay with Magicbricks Now for more news and updates.